Hello and welcome back to another night of bedtime stories. Tonight is chapter 17 from Mr. Tweedy by Anne Marie Schelling. As Ann Arbor, Michigan was the only place en route where we had any relatives, I had been looking forward to our promised visit with my niece Helen and her family. The Chapmans were also camping and traveling minded, having crossed the country in a camper the previous year. I would glean much valuable information on road conditions, hazards, and best routes to follow. However, even knowing the worth and pleasure of this stopover, I dreaded it. From sunrise to sunset to get acquainted in the neighborhood, what if Mr. Tweedy liked the surroundings? What if he found a feathered friend to take our place? After coming so close to losing him, at least thinking that he was leaving us at Windsor, I had no desire to live through such moments again in a rush. To be sure, they would come, but I'd rather they didn't until we were closer to our destination. Better yet, not until we had reached home safely. Naturally, I didn't expect him to save our lives again, but having done so once, somehow I felt safer just having him around. When I suggested we bypass Frank and Helen's place, the children wouldn't hear of it. They wanted to see Karen, Patty, and Randy, and Dave was convinced Mr. Tweedy wouldn't leave him, even if we stopped for a week. So once again, I gave in to my son, and once again, he was right. All day while I visited with Helen and my sisters, Gladys, who was down for the summer and caught up with the laundry situation, the children kept busy and happy outdoors with Mr. Tweedy. But not only did he play with them that morning in his own little way, he taught them a lesson in sportsmanship. Unable to purchase real butterfly nets in the shopping center, I had settled for two long-handled fly swatters, which the children were using out on the lawn. When Dave saw that the sound of a swat invariably brought his pet zooming in for an anticipated morsel, a fly or an ant, he began to tease Mr. Tweedy by swatting at nothing. After being fooled twice, Mr. Tweedy simply flew up to the peak of the now-roofed ranch house, and no amount of the children's calling would make him fly down. Realizing that he shouldn't have teased his little pet, Dave hauled out a ladder to climb to the roof. Mr. Tweedy would come to him there, and Dave would tell him that he was sorry. As anticipated, when Dave reached his robin, Mr. Tweedy obligingly hopped onto Dave's arm and let himself be carried down. However, the moment Dave reached the ground, off flew the bird to the peak of the roof. After several times of this climbing bit, my chastised son got onto his hands and knees to seriously look for ants. Like a judge from his lofty perch, Mr. Tweedy watched and waited. Then, at the first legitimate swat, even before Dave could turn to call him, the wise little robin had flown down to his side. Thereafter, there was no more teasing. The rest of the day went fine, but then in the evening, our robin got himself into a real predicament. Like a baby, he was always putting things in his mouth which shouldn't be there. Left on his own for a little while, he evidently found a rather long piece of string. No one had seen him eating it, but suddenly there was our little bird hopping over to me with an inch or so of this string dangling out of his beak. As if he knew I could help him, he stood in front of me, cocking his head with his beak partially open as if he were trying to regurgitate. The moment I got hold of the dangling bit, he slowly backed away from me. Every few inches he would stop and wait for me to get a good grip closer to his beak. Then he'd back up another few inches. By the time we finished, I had in my hand nearly 3 feet of string. Do all little birds get in such predicaments? I wondered. I didn't envy a mother robin. The following day, once again, our happy quartet was on the road. As if to prove to the world that he truly was glad to be traveling, suddenly Mr. Tweedy, who hadn't sung once at Ann Arbor, gave vent to a jubilant burst of melody. Coming so unexpectedly, it sent us into gales of laughter. In no time, we were all singing our way down the open road. This afternoon, as planned, we stopped early to spend the night at Warren Dunes State Park. Unfortunately, at that point, a terrific cloud burst had broken over our heads. The rain was coming down in torrents, forming rivulets coming down the rear window, which Mr. Tweedy went wild about. He was pecking away at the window, fluffing his feather the way he did when he bathed. For the life of him, he couldn't figure out why he wasn't getting wet. Once again, unable to exercise their bird outdoors, the children amused themselves with him in the trailer until bedtime. When they were asleep, I tried to get caught up with the travelogue, but what a ridiculous time I had. Instead of sitting on my perch, Mr. Tweedy acted like a little clown. Flying down to the table, he settled himself beside my paper. Then, as I wrote the lines, he followed the motion of my hand. Never was anything more comical. The way his head moved, he looked like he was reading and trying to write. With Robin chasing every word, just didn't work out. Before long, I shooed him back to his perch and went to bed. By sunrise, the weather had changed completely. When I opened the door, I was greeted by a forest wonderland. Through the heavy canopy of leaves, brilliant shafts of sunlight cut individual swaths through the rising haze. From a distance, the call of a wood thrush thrilled its way through the rain-washed air. From my shoulder, a robin sang softly into my ear. "It's a beautiful world, isn't it?" I whispered to my little friend. Again, the wood thrush thrilled his beautiful crystal notes through the forest. "And out there is where you really belong. So what is keeping you? Why won't you fly away?" With the door wide open to the forest wonderland, I stood deep in thought, wondering what magnetism held him. From the upper bunk, a voice whispered, "What are you doing up so early, Mom?" And suddenly, my shoulder was empty. My robin had flown to a little boy. That ends chapter 17 of Mr. Tweedy by Anne-Marie Schilling. Tune in tomorrow for chapter 18. And we'll conclude tonight with a bedtime prayer. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for providing us with what we need. Protect us and keep us safe. Help us to get a good night's rest. And help us to wake up tomorrow feeling refreshed and revived and ready to take on the day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good night.